Welcome back inside the International Space Station Flight Control Room. We're joined by astronaut Cady Coleman. Cady, as we've been talking throughout the past few days, the Japanese cargo ship, the HTV-4, the Kanatori 4, is en route to the International Space Station after its launch back on Saturday from the Tanegashima Space Center in southern Japan. Series of rendezvous burns has fine-tuned its path and it's set up for an arrival at the station on Friday. Now, Karen Nyberg and Chris Cassidy are in charge of trying to haul that cargo ship in and to make it a part of the International Space Station for a month. You had the honor and the task of actually grappling the HTV-2 back in January of 2011, about a month after you arrived on the International Space Station. Tell us a little bit about the techniques and the complexity of what they're going to be experiencing out of the cupola on Friday morning.
So this idea, Rob, of having, you know, two things come close together in space and then reaching out with a robotic arm and grabbing one of them and attaching it, you know, it's not new in that we've done it a lot of times on the space shuttle. For example, the Hubble Space Telescope. We would go rendezvous with that, reach out, grab it, spend some time repairing it. But the big difference here on a space station is that basically the space station can't move away. If things go wrong and you tip off the telescope and it starts tumbling or it just doesn't look right to you, the commander of that space shuttle can fly that space shuttle away, but the space station is way too big. So it makes it a more critical operation to get things just right. And so as this supply ship comes closer and closer, it's basic. We always have the ability to tell it to go away if we need to, but it's going to arrive at a place. It's about, you know, I don't know, 30 feet away from the station, 15 feet from the robotic arm, and that's pretty close. And so it's going to arrive there, and the robotic arm is kind of perched, ready just to move in like this. And that's Karen's job. You'll actually hear Chris talking on the radio, because the person who is M2, or robotics operator number 2, who's backing Karen up, he'll probably do most of the talking, where Karen is at the controls, and she's looking at a target. And there's a target, there's a camera on top of the arm, so 1 and then 2. And that camera is moving in, looking at a target, where the real arm, the part of the arm that would actually grab this thing, is actually about this big. I mean, it's giant. And so both of those things are moving in at the same time. She's lining up perfectly. You know, and if when we say, okay, ready, set, go, that's when we don't want that spacecraft to decide it wants to go here or there. So we turn off the capability of it to go anywhere. And so if it was already kind of on its way, sailing a little bit left, because while it was waiting, it was kind of holding itself in a little box, back and forth, up and down. If it was on its way sailing, when we say, no more jet firings for you, that means that Karen has to follow it with the robotic arm. And that's where it can be tricky. And it can be even trickier if it's on its way, you know, with a little more force and motion. And we always have to be ready for that. So that's what they've been doing lately, is just getting ready to, you know, practicing following something that is racing away from you.
And does the mass of HTV-4, 16 tons of mass, does that make it even more complicated?
It does make it more complicated, because we basically don't want to hurt the robotic arm. We're going to have supply ships arriving again and again at the International Space Station. And if it was racing too fast and you caught it in such a way that you didn't just kind of go with it, then that could strain the arm, put forces on the arm. So it really has to be a very precise, very much lined up operation. And, you know, I was nervous doing it. I'll tell you, I was certainly nervous doing it. And at the same time, that's where your training comes back into play, where you've practiced this over and over again. And knowing that you've done your best to be ready, that's when you can put all that stuff out the window and just kind of focus on doing what you've done many times before. It's just, I'd say what's significant is that in the training, in the sort of cartoon virtual reality world that we train in, nothing looks that big. I mean, this thing is huge, and it's right next to the window of the space station, and it's pretty cool looking down at the Earth as it gets bigger, you know, throughout the day on their Friday, our Thursday night. That thing is going to look like a tiny little speck on the horizon, and then it's just going to get bigger and bigger and bigger, and by the time it arrives and you're going to catch it, it is huge.
So they're going to be operating out of the cupola, which of course is the station's wonderful window on the world. But in reality, it's pretty cramped quarters. So you have Karen and Chris side by side. Luca's right there monitoring the spacecraft systems, making sure that it's doing what it's supposed to do. How How much of a kludge is that for the crew?
It is challenging because it is physically close. There's really not any more room than you and I sitting here. And yet they've actually practiced just that. I mean, just yesterday morning, they practiced using the robotic arm and figuring out who's going to be where, and when somebody needs to reach that button, do they knock Karen out of the way? You know, they'll have figured out their own way to sort of use that space and their own communication together, too, of saying, you know, as the arm is approaching, we need to make sure that the spacecraft is in a certain state. And so, you know, Cassidy will be looking at that and telling Karen, you know, the spacecraft is free drift, you are go to proceed. So there's a lot of precise communication back and forth. And, you know, we're NASA, we practice that stuff. And we practice, what if this happens, what if this happens. There'll be one more significant practice session on basically their Thursday morning to just reinforce, you know, we have all these what if situations. What if suddenly the spacecraft shows that it's got some systems that are not ready, and it would be better to send it away and wait until we can understand the state of the spacecraft. There's two things that Chris can do. He can push a button that says retreat, which means it goes back to the last place it waited, which is about 100 feet away. Or he can push a button that says abort, which actually sends it, you know, to a very far away waiting place. So, excuse me, they've got some options. We really talked through and practiced those options. And also then, on top of that, you want to capture these moments, both for an engineering reason. What if something goes wrong? You want to understand. You want the ground to understand. What do we need to do different on the next supply ship? And also, you just want to capture the fact that this is a significant thing that real people are doing.
And then once it's captured, the crew takes a quick break, catch its breath, and then they go through this finely choreographed procedure to maneuver it into place so it can slowly but surely be mated to the Earth-facing port of the Harmony module. So how complex is that? How precise a maneuver is that? Because in part, it's also ground-assisted here by the robotics officer in mission control.
That's correct. And, you know, we're always torn in terms of who gets to do the work on the space station. Ideally, as a crew member, as an astronaut, we want to do all the robotic arm stuff because we love to fly things. We like to do things. But it's actually more efficient for the controllers down here to make some of those moves where they take it from out here where you captured it to then a position that is all lined up but about 6 feet away from being mated to the station. And so it's more efficient for the ground to go ahead and make those moves, so they probably will make those moves. But whether the crew makes them or whether the ground makes them is no matter what, there's math involved. And those things have been figured out ahead of time, and it's a precise set of coordinates. But then when you really are going to put metal to metal, and, you know, the HTV has, like, these kind of, you know, little cutouts like this, and then the space station has ones like this, and so those things are going to touch, and they really have to exactly kind of mesh together. That's where the ground can do that. I mean, we're getting so the ground could do that, where they bring it in, and we see little indications, doing well. We can actually feel with the robotic arm, it's got sensors that say, hey, I'm being tugged this way. And so as we do that, we actually see how much strain is on the arm, so we can make sure that even if we think our math is correct, what if something's wrong? You know, are the mechanical parts really meshing together without putting strain on the space station? Because we need that port again, and we need to be able to undock safely and send our supply ship, now trash ship, away. And we need to make sure our robotic arm isn't getting strain either.
And so once in place, ready to latch, indications are seen by the crew, and then it's a matter of bolting it in place in a two-stage fashion, and then it's part of the space station for the next month, so its valuable cargo can be unloaded. Cady Coleman, 180 days in space on three flights, 159 days in space as part of Expedition 26-27, and who captured HTV-2 about 2.5 years ago. Thanks for joining us today with the insight. And just a note, our programming on Friday morning in two parts will be on the air at 5 a.m. Central Time, 6 a.m. Eastern Time for Rendezvous and Grapple of the HTV-4, with the actual capture expected just before 6:30 a.m. Central Time on Friday morning. We'll take a break, and then we'll return for live coverage of its installation beginning at 8 a.m. Central Time, 9 Eastern Time, all of that on Friday morning. Thanks very much, Cady.
You're welcome. It's going to be really exciting.